Hi everyone. A lot of you have been submitting YouTube comments, and a lot of you guys have questions on prostate cancer that you would like us to ask Dr. Scholz. And today, we're going to answer those questions. What exactly causes so many men to die of prostate cancer each year? It seems that there are both primary and secondary causes of death. So liver failure is secondary to prostate cancer. They just would like to know the breakdown.
Well, I mean, the things that cause prostate cancer death are either bone marrow failure, because if you think about it, prostate cancer spreads to the bones. Bone marrow failure means progressive anemia, where people have to get transfusions all the time. Susceptibility to infections, because the bone marrow is where your immune system is made, or bleeding problems, because that's where the clotting functions that help your blood to clot normally are made. So you mentioned liver. Liver is very susceptible. Thankfully, prostate cancer doesn't usually spread to the liver unless it's very advanced. And so, but if it does, that can be a real problem. Obviously, we need our livers to be able to function metabolically in a normal way. So it's really those two things are the most common thing. And the other thing is what oftentimes on death certificates, people are put down if they've had prostate cancer. This is some of the confusion about the COVID too. If they've had a COVID infection and they die, well, if you have a heart attack when you had the COVID infection, they call it a death from COVID. And if you have a heart attack while you have advanced prostate cancer, they'll call it a prostate cancer death sometimes. So it's not a super precise. Well, what really caused the death? Sometimes it's a combination of old age, other medical problems, plus the prostate cancer. And oftentimes the decision to call it a death from prostate cancer is quite arbitrary.
Okay, our next question is, how much longer might the average patient live after getting the treatment Lutetium-177? So for the audience, they may not know what Lutetium is. Can you explain that first?
So lutetium is a new targeted radiation that's available outside the country right now and pending FDA approval here in the United States. Novartis Pharmaceuticals purchased this technology for about $2 billion a couple years ago, I think, now. And we're waiting the results of phase 3 trials to confirm that it does make people live longer. Survival after lutetium is going to depend very much on how aggressive the cancer was going into the treatment. So if someone has had every known treatment and gets a poor response to lutetium, because not everyone responds to it, survival could be less than a year. On the other hand, people that go into lutetium with relatively small tumor volume and who've been doing well, they could live many, many years after lutetium.
Now, you've had patients treated with this. What has the effects been?
So the patients that we sent over to Germany or to Australia for treatment, patients had to pay out of pocket for this. Insurance didn't cover it. They had typically had advanced disease, which was resistant to chemotherapy, resistant to second-line hormone therapy, Xtandi, Zytiga, Erleada, et cetera, and were in dire straits. And our experience with the treatment is that about one-third of the men that underwent this treatment had dramatic and useful responses, big drops in PSA and reversal of the disease that no doubt made them live longer. And about two-thirds or one-third, things sort of went sideways, and about one-third, it didn't seem to work at all.
So the one-third that did respond well, are they in durable remissions currently?
The patients that, I can't recall off the top of my head, but we do have patients that have had continued remissions, and then we've had patients that have had remissions for 6 to 12, 24 months, and then the cancer started coming back again.
So, Dr. Scholz, we're getting outside of prostate cancer a little bit here and just going into prostate with BPH and prostatitis. The first question is, regarding BPH, this person is thinking of skipping the drug stage and just going straight to UroLift or Resume, and they would like to know if that's okay.
Well, my answer is it's your body. It's okay. The reason that I don't generally think in that sequence is my preference is to start with reversible treatments because every treatment has a potential side effect, and side effects can be categorized as reversible or irreversible. And the side effects from most medications are reversible with rare exceptions, whereas the side effects from procedures are occasionally irreversible. And there's just less risk in starting off with some of the medication approaches than there is with jumping right into a procedure. But that's how someone wants to live their life. If they are informed as to what the pros and cons are, that's their option.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because I think so often when it comes to health issues like prostate, BPH, prostatitis, prostate cancer, the quality of life aspect is not something that someone immediately thinks about because they're in survival mode or wanting to deal with the problem. But these long-term side effects and things that people are dealing with, and then having to deal with those side effects and causing problems later down the line, and I 100% appreciate that you say that because I think that it's PCRI's job to really tell people your quality of life really matters. And if you can do something that's reversible, it's so important. And I know I'm preaching to the choir here, but I want our audience to know, you know, it's like when you jump to these treatments like surgery and radiation and prostate cancer and all that stuff, when instead of seeing what you really have, dealing with the problem accordingly, and then dealing with the quality of life issues, I think it's detrimental.
It's kind of juggling a few different things at the same time, and that's difficult for some people. This is why it's nice to team up with someone, have a partner, get second opinions, take your time, and really make sure that people understand the pros and cons of all the different options and then make a decision rather than just making an immediate emotional decision that you may regret later.
Our next question goes into prostatitis, and this person is asking, is there such a thing as nonbacterial prostatitis?
There certainly is. It's incredibly common. Maybe as many as 1 out of 4 men are facing nonbacterial prostatitis, so they may be unaware of it. Nonbacterial prostatitis could manifest just as some calcium on a scan that you see in, without ever being related to any symptoms whatsoever. It could be presenting just as a high PSA that you can't explain any other way. So the nonbacterial prostatitis issue is very widespread and it's not very well understood. Since it's asymptomatic, a lot of times people just ignore it. Some men can get nonbacterial prostatitis, and they have discomfort in the pelvic region, burning with urination, feeling sick, and certainly can represent a huge challenge, and whole books have been written about nonbacterial prostatitis.
Our next question goes into diet, and so we're kind of going into the nutrition, health, and wellness categories here. So, does eating fresh fruit impact prostate cancer? So I think this person's really talking about the sugar.
Yeah, I don't. Well, first, while sugar issues are thought to be very important with things like pancreas cancer, lung cancer, they're not thought to be as big a priority with prostate cancer. We worry more about animal fats, animal proteins, than we do about sugar. So I have not prescribed or come out against patients eating fruit that have prostate cancer. There are some very stringent vegetarian diets that do take that stance, and I'm not a dietary expert, but you're getting into pretty esoteric and very restricted diets when you get to the level of saying you need to avoid fruit. And I think there's a lot of other things I would consider before I went to such an extreme.
Are there particular foods to avoid with Gleason 6 prostate cancer?
Well, we don't think of Gleason 6 really as being a cancer. It doesn't spread. It does sometimes scare people into unnecessary treatment. That's probably the main danger. So if people are concerned about their health, they should be following a diet that they think will minimize the risk of heart disease. Just because someone has a harmless prostate cancer doesn't mean now that you can throw caution to the wind and just ignore your health in general. But it's not fair to tell people with Gleason 6 that they should be afraid of their cancer and they should change their whole lifestyle on the basis of the cancer alone, because we know it's a harmless condition.
This person asks, when you talk about the effects of fat in the diet of prostate cancer, are you speaking specifically to animal fats, or are there plant-based fats, including nuts and olive oils and avocados, to be concerned about?
I think there's levels of intensity, and I think realistically, we're talking about animal fats. When we talk about eating animal protein, it's always mixed in with animal fats. And the reason we take fats seriously is based on a variety of studies that show that these prostate tumors on PET scans pick up these fats really quickly, and they're a real high energy source. So one could extrapolate and say, well, shouldn't you avoid vegetable fats as well? And I'm not sure anyone really knows the answer to that. If they do, I don't. But I usually sort of draw the line at trying to cut back on animal protein, which thus also eliminates animal fats, and tell patients that if it comes from a plant, that it's probably fine.
Our next question is really, are there any long clinical trials showing that switching from a meat-based diet to a vegetarian diet or plant-based diet has any effect on lowering PSA or anything like that?
Yeah, Dean Ornish published some work. Did you say advanced prostate cancer or just any prostate cancer?
Just any prostate cancer.
Dean Ornish did some studies in earlier stage prostate cancer showing that changes in diet and lifestyle inhibited PSA rise. And I've observed it also in men that have had rising PSAs after surgery, who we check PSAs monthly and show that once they flip over to a new diet, that the rate of PSA rise is altered almost immediately. So it's kind of a seeing is believing thing. This pattern of patients adopting different lifestyles and noting a big change in their PSA patterns, it's something I've seen over and over again. It's a very real phenomenon to me.
Going off that question, this person says that Dr. Scholz doesn't really distinguish between the vegan diet and the vegetarian diet. The vegan diet, eliminating all products of animal origin, and the vegetarian diet does include things like milk and eggs. And so where does milk and eggs lie on that?
How serious do you want to get about diet? And that's probably answered by how serious is the cancer. We go to the extreme of the Gleason 6 folks, and there's no motivation to change your diet at all just based on that. Men that have advanced hormone refractory disease who are literally fighting for their lives, I would definitely eliminate the milk and eggs.
Thank you guys so much for commenting on our YouTube videos. We really appreciate your questions, and it's an honor to be able to answer them. If you would like further information about any of the topics that we talked about today, you can visit our website at pcri.org. If you haven't already subscribed to our channel, please do so. You can hit the subscribe button below. And if you have more questions, go ahead and leave them in all of our YouTube comments. Our team will pick it up from there. We hope you have a great week.